Michelle, I'm going to ask you to stand for this. Page 69.
But any year feel like you get thrown under the bus?
What?
Have you ever felt like you got thrown under the bus?
More than one time, I have.
Now we ready, Sister Judy?
Soon I come to the end of my journey.
Certainly miss the ones that are not here. There are several that are not. And the ones that have braved the weather to be here, and some of you have traveled long distances. And we are thankful to see each and every one and have hope and pray you have safe journeys back home. We want to remember tonight's service at 5 p.m. Brother Aubrey, as Brother Jimmy would say, bring somebody with you. And Wednesday night, I guess Brother Tony's going to be doing that, unless Brother Doug's able. We don't know about him yet. But we're glad this morning, like Brother Jim's not here. Brother Darrell's just jumped in and led the singing. And God's people here do what they need to do to make it work for God. And we're very thankful for that. At this time, we're going to have prayer, another song, and then we'll take up the offering. So, Brother Aubrey, would you lead us in prayer at this time?
Home is represented, each heart, Lord. I pray, Lord, that be in our midst today, bless each one, or help us to draw closer to you, Lord. There's one in our midst that don't know you, Father, and is looking to Savior. I pray, Father, that you would bless them as their faith will grow, and they might become saved today, Lord. Towards everlasting to know, Father, I just pray that each and everything that is said and done will be to your glory, that you bless Brother Danny as he speaks to us, and you anoint him, Lord, and help us, Lord, to learn more about you and your word. Father, I pray that you bless the saints, Lord, that it would bring you honor and glory. Father, I just pray, Lord, each and every time we say, would you, Lord, participate, and you just bless hearts and lives here today. And all things we give you, thanks and praise. In Jesus' name I pray.
Our next song, you may be seated. If you'll get your red book and turn to page 112, there's an old song there called Touring That City. It's a celebration song. And because it's a celebration song, all parts of it are important. I'm going to play it in the introduction. We're going to do it a little different. There's only two verses. And the chorus is real special. Talks about some morning we'll find ourselves touring that city. So we're going to sing the chorus first, and then just sing the song like it's written. First verse, chorus, second verse, chorus. So I'll play a little so you'll remember it.
I listened to it 12 times this morning from the Inspirations. I still can't figure it out. So heavy, but in heaven, no one better than
You know, that's a, I don't know, music is not my thing for sure, but that's a tough song. I think it's more of a quartet type song.
Yeah, it is.
And so it's hard for a congregation to get that one out. I don't know why he left. He's got to come back and do another one, right?
Yes, but we'll just let him come back and stay.
Okay. He's got to regain his composure.
Yes, he does.
Brother Darrell, I have to pick on you a little bit. I think I've covered most of the announcements, haven't I?
I think you have. I do wonder, Crystal's mom and dad are needing prayer, and Sherry and Ray Tummins. Ray was in the hospital, but he's still not well and needing a lot of tests, so we need to remember them.
Let's remember all these folks, as we talked about in Sunday school. There's so many that are sick in different ways. It's just unimaginable how many people can be so sick in so many different directions. But prayer heals people. But God heals them through prayer. We're a firm believer in that. That's part of the part of my message this morning. When we get to that. This is a very prayerful church. I'm very thankful to be part of it because I've seen the prayers go through and be answered, and I've seen some things happen. All the people that's here visiting, again, thank you. The ones that are not here, we miss. We're glad to see Elvira back. She's been out for a little bit, any others. So at this time, if there's nothing else, we will take up the morning offering. We'll ask Brother Les and Brother Larry if they will come forward at this time while we receive the offering. I'll go ahead and bless the offering. Let's bow our heads. Lord, we thank you for this day, your love, your mercy, and your grace. We pray, Lord, thank you for being able, Lord, to serve you. We pray, Lord, for this offering that you bless those that have to give and bless those that have not. May it be used for the furtherance of your service. And we ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Mentioned Sister Debbie slipped in on us too. We're glad to see her this morning.
That's good. Near the cross.
I love that song.
169. Go ahead and turn in the blue book to page 169. When Brother Danny had requested this, and I was looking at it, and I thought, this is a song of prayer. And we're still in the beginning of a new year, and this is the prayer we should have. Lord, keep me
near. Well, Sister Judy, I told Sister TJ back there she could have come up here and helped me. And maybe not have to do this alone, but
no,
I got through under the bus. But most of all, I love the Lord. He wants his children to smile and be happy.
Amen.
And this is a beautiful song. I wish Jimmy was here to sing it. Jesus, keep me.
Thank you.
You know, Brother Jim being absent makes you appreciate him a whole lot more, but don't tell him I said that. I didn't mention this morning the fact that my back's been messed up this week. I'm kind of scattered here, so excuse me. Yeah, it does that every now and then. So I tried to rest it yesterday. I basically had a rough week physically, but you know what that old saying is, when you get old, your back goes out more than you do. So mine's went out a lot more this week than I have, that's for sure. But I'm here today, and God's going to take care of it. And it's an amazing thing what God does every day for us. And if I'm a little scattered, forgive me. It's definitely anything that's bad goes on up here, it's me. If it's good, it's God. So just keep that in mind always. I had this message laid out, God give me on the Holy Spirit. Remember, we were supposed to be back on the Holy Spirit for a little while longer. Well, about midwake again, he wakes me up in the night. I don't know why he likes to do that, but I'm not going to question him. He gave me just a clear-cut, different message. He even gave me four places the Bible go to. All there, just, this is it. This is what you do. And I said, you know, what are you going to do? You're going to do what he tells you, or you're going to get in some real serious trouble. So that's what I did, and so that's what we're doing this morning. And he's very clear about it. The message is, he wants us to be reminded of his presence in our life. And I'm thinking, well, the children of God knows he's present in their life, but that's not the point. He wants the message to be about his presence in our life, so that's what we're doing. And there's got to be a reason. There's got to be some, even if it's one person here that this message is for, then it's for you. So God don't make no errors or mistakes. Now, it's kind of like anybody that knows me personally knows that I'm a big fan of old Westerns. You know, you just put me in front of and my favorite, I like Gunsmoke and all the others, but Wagon Train had the most religious storylines of any old Western or old TV show there was, if you follow that. They prayed a lot. They had services. It was all godly. So anyway, enough of that. What I was going to say was, without trying to get sidetracked too much, in the Western shows, there was always a time almost in every show when there was a fight going on and they needed reinforcements, okay? It don't matter who it was, if it was the cavalry, here comes the cavalry, you know, reinforcement. So today, I think God is telling us, even though we know his presence, sometimes we need reinforced in our life the presence of God in our life. And he gives us great examples in the scripture, and that's what we're going to get to here in a moment. As a matter of fact, we're going to, and even though it's not the Holy Spirit message per se, it's still the Holy Spirit is always present in our lives as well. You know, When we talk about being filled with the Holy Spirit, which every child of God is, and whether sometimes the Spirit is speaking to us, it's not always. My wife is glad I'm not always talking to her, even if I'm present with her all the time. Sometimes she may just sit there and be quiet, but she knows I'm there just the same. Well, that's the way it is with the Spirit of God. Sometimes, you know, he just don't say something, but he's still there just the same. And God's there because he is the Spirit in us, God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. So when you're filled with the Spirit of God,
all of the Holy Spirit. God is in your life, and Jesus is in your life. It's a three-in-one deal we get when we get saved. And I like to remind myself of that, and I want us as children of God to all be reminded of that. I may never get to the message, I don't know. But here we go. We'd like to start off reading, and again, I may be a little scattered, forgive me for that. In Acts chapter 9 and verse 40 and 41, I'm going to try to give you at least 10 seconds without timing. I could take 10 sips of water, that way I won't get hiccups as well. Okay, everybody's turned there. You probably won't make it to the next three, but at least you get the first one. Acts 9, verse 40 and 41 says, "But Peter put them all forth and kneeled down and prayed, and turning him to the body, said, Tabitha, arise. And she opened her eyes, and when she saw Peter, she sat up, and he gave her his hand and lifted her up. And when he had called the saints and widows, presented her alive." And let's pray at this time. Father in heaven, how thankful we are, Lord, to serve thee, to be in thy house. Each and every child of God, Lord, is your servant. We serve at your pleasure to do your will in our lives. And we pray, Lord, for all those that's been mentioned this morning, Lord, touch and heal those that are sick and be with any that are bereaved. Lord, comfort them. Lord, we pray, Heavenly Father, for those traveling, you give them safe journeys. We pray, Lord, especially this morning, Lord, if there's one here that's lost and does not know Jesus as their Savior, this would be the very hour they would come to know him before it's everlasting too late. We ask you, Lord, to please bless this word, the reading of it. May it accomplish your purpose. And we ask all this in Jesus' precious and holy name, and amen. This first example was, we know, most of us, many of us might know the story about this young lady who was a dedicated disciple of God. Her name was Tabitha. She was a good Christian lady. She was a dedicated, as we said, disciple, and she did much works. She did much alms, and what that meant was she was always doing for the other people, and especially the widows, as it's mentioned. She was always making them garments and coats and all this, and this good worker for God, and lo and behold, she up and died for some reason. And so it came pass in verse 37 that she just got sick and died. And so we say, well, why? Why would that happen to a child of God? I don't know how old she was. I think she was a young lady and in her prime and doing all these things. And so that's not part of this message, but we'll get to the other part in a minute. But Isaiah 57 and 1 and 2 said, "The righteous man perisheth, and no man layeth it to heart, and merciful men are taken away, none considering that the righteous is then that is taken away from the evil to come." It means it perishes, it continues to perish, and the evil to come. When we think about that, we're thinking about evil in general, don't we? We think about there's an evil out in this world to come upon this world, and it's already here in its present form. But every individual life, there's things. I've conducted lots of funerals, and I remind people when this person maybe was a younger person, and in my mind, I'm thinking according to this scripture, if they're a child of God and God takes them home early, he's protecting them from the evil to come. There was something maybe personally in their life that was going to come upon them, an evil, that God took them away from that. And you can get comfort in that and knowing that, why that happened. Because a lot of people say, well, why did that happen to that person, that child of God, like this lady here that was so proud time and doing so much, and all of a sudden God took her home, and Isaiah tells us there's a reason for that in many cases. But getting back to the subject at hand, Peter was nearby and Lydda, this was in Joppa, so they sent for Peter, knowing who he was and what he was doing, and they called him, and we read where he came in, and notice what happened when they called for him. What did he do? He prayed. Notice in verse 40, he put them all forth, and he kneeled down and prayed. That's what God's children do. We pray to God all the time, but in special circumstances in our lives and other people's lives, we get on our knees and we pray to God that he will hear and answer that prayer at that time. And this is an instantaneous thing that happened. He wasn't praying for something to happen 5 years later. He was praying a momentarily answered prayer. And those take place in the Bible, as we're going to see, and they take place in our lives. And what happened was God heard and answered that prayer. God made his presence known. That's what took place. God made his presence known, and he turned to the girl. He says, "Arise." She opened her eyes and she saw him. She sat up, and he gave her his hand. He lifted her up, and when he had called what? The saints and the widows, he presented her alive. God made his presence known to his people, and he delivered this girl and brought her back to life, if you will, through the prayer of Peter. And so prayer made God's presence known. Now, turn with me a little further over into Acts chapter 12, and chapter 12, verses 11 through 17. And there we find, do I need to go one Mississippi, two Mississippi, 10 times? No, I'm just kidding. That's just a couple pages over. So chapter 12, verses 11 through 17. Chapter 12, verse 11 through 17. And when he had considered the thing, guess who we're talking about? Peter. When he had considered the thing, he came to the house of Mary, the mother of John, whose surname was Mark, where many were gathered together praying. Verse 5 says, the church prayed without ceasing. Talking about what they're praying for here. The church prayed without ceasing. Here, Peter came to himself. He came to Mary's house where many were gathered praying. In verse 13, and as Peter knocked at the door of the gate, a damsel came to hearken named Rhoda. And when she knew Peter's voice, she opened not the gate for gladness, but ran in and told how Peter stood before the gate. And they said unto her, thou art mad. But she constantly affirmed that it was even so. Then said they, it is his angel. But Peter continued knocking. And when they had opened the door and saw him, they were astonished. But he beckoning unto them with a hand to hold their peace, declared unto them how the Lord had brought him out of the prison. And he said, go show these things unto James and to the brethren. And he departed and went into another place. Herod Agrippa, actually the first, the grandson of Herod the Great, had Peter imprisoned. And God's angel, if you go back and read in front of what we just read, God's angel let Peter out of the prison and let him out into the city there. And that's where he came to himself. Verse 12 says, Christians were gathered together praying. Now in verse 14, the girl recognized his voice, but she was overcome with joy. And she didn't even open the door. She just ran back to tell the others. She recognized the voice of Peter through the gate. It was nighttime, I think. But she was so happy, she didn't open the door. She ran and told the rest of them. What did they say? They were there praying for Peter's release. He was standing at the door knocking, and she went and told them, and they said basically, you're crazy. You're mad. And she said, no, he's out there. And they said, then they made up another excuse. It must have been his angel. No, it was Peter. And finally, he just kept on knocking and beating on that door. And finally, they opened the door and let him in, and there he stood. And so what happened here was that God's people prayed. God made his presence known, and prayers were answered. God had made his presence known to these children. Now, we might say, well, why did it happen that way? Why did they not believe at that moment? I don't have but one explanation. I don't know if it's right or not. When I'm praying and it's answered that quick, I'm not expecting God to answer it that quick. And for whatever reason, if somebody, I would probably be in that group. Somebody come say, well, your prayer got answered, he's out. I'll say, no, not that quick. Couldn't happen that way. I've got to pray long. I've got to pray for weeks and months for this to take place. No, it don't have to be that long. God can hear and answer your prayer in an instant. God makes his presence known in God's people's lives every single moment and every single hour of every single day. That's what he wants us to know. He makes his presence known. Now, let's look over again in Acts 20 and moving on ahead in Acts 20. We got there in one more place. Going to be quick, I believe, today. Who knows? Okay, Acts 20 and verses 7 through 12. Now, before I read this, I got to tell you something that ties into these verses. This is almost like 2 weeks ago. Okay, so me and my daughter and her friend are coming along, Michael, there, down to church today. And Michael said, let me tell you this Bible story I was thinking about, or whatever the way he worded it, the church story you'll get a kick out of. So he begins to tell me, word for word, this verses I'm fixing to read. And I said, you're not going to believe that's part of my message. And he said, you're going to get a kick out of this. I said, you're going to get a kick. Well, I'm going to tell you, because you just told me what I'm going to tell you in a minute. So in these verses, chapter 20, verse 7 through 12, he already knows it. Everybody else don't. And upon the first day of the week, when the disciples came together to break bread, Paul preached unto them, ready to depart on the morrow, and continued his speech until midnight. And there were many lights in the upper chamber, and they were gathered together, and there sat in the window a certain man named Eutychus, being fallen down from the third loft, and was taken up dead. Now, let me get to my right page here. And Paul went down and fell on him, and embracing him, said, trouble not yourselves, for his life is in him. When he therefore was come up again, and had broken bread, and eaten and talked a long while, even till break of day, so he departed, And they brought the young man alive and were not a little comforted. Now, Michael, you took the sting out of my message, okay? No, I'm just kidding. So here's Paul, and he was at Troas, and he was fixing to leave. And so here it was, the first day of the week. That's the Lord's day. That's today. Today is the Lord's day, the first day of the week. That's the day that the apostles and the disciples established as the Lord's day for us to worship on. That's why it's not the Sabbath day yesterday. We're not living that. We're living the grace dispensation period of time when the Lord's day is the first day of the week. I'm not bad-mouthing any other group. I'm just telling you what the Bible is teaching us, okay? They preached and taught on the first day of the week. Now, so they also took the Lord's Supper on the first day of the week, but not always. We're going to get to that in a second, technically speaking. So they came together to break bread because Paul was, he preached to them. He was going to go away tomorrow. And Paul continued his speech to midnight, okay? Now, it was well lit, and in the upper chamber they were gathered. That's the third loft up. Now, I don't know how high that was, but I'm thinking three tiers. And that's a good ways up, okay? You don't have to be far up to fall and die. Trust me, I know. I was working 40 feet from a man, and we was on the second story. And he was tearing his forms off the edge of the concrete floor we were standing on. And he flipped over the edge and hit the floor two stories below, and it killed him. And so, you know, when you're the third loft up and you fall, and you're dead. That's what it says here. It says he was is taken up dead. It don't say he was taken up almost dead. He was dead as dead can be, if you'll pardon the bad language, sir. But anyway, when this happened, he got tired and he got sleepy because Paul had preached to midnight. And it was a long message. Now, it must have been a good message because, you know, if I'm listening to another preacher, I go to get antsy about 20 or 30 minutes into his message unless it's mighty good. And I know I preach sometimes 40 minutes or so. And I know it's a little long for everybody, but goodness gracious, he preached till midnight, and it was midnight before finally one person fell asleep and fell dead. But Paul went down and fell on this man and said, he embraced him and said, "Trouble not yourselves, for his life is in him." God made his presence known right in the middle of the message. We don't have to wait till the message is over. God can make his presence known right now.
Amen.
If there's a soul here that wants to be saved, you don't have to wait till I'm done. You can come on up here right now. So God made his presence known right in the middle of the message, all-nighter. Man, what a message that must have been. I can't even imagine preaching all night long. How'd he get the breath? Boy, God sure empowered him, didn't he? So God made his presence known. But notice this now before we move on. In verse 11 and 12, and when he therefore was come up again, now this was, and had broken bread and eaten and talked a little while longer, even to break of day, so he departed. Now, this was midnight when all this took place. So it was a little after midnight, and they broke bread, technically speaking, on the next day, but it don't matter. We can break bread on Good Friday. We can break bread tomorrow. Only the way to do it is in good conscience and knowing that God is in it. Not for our own benefit, but for Him as a remembrance to Him. Not only does these verses make God's presence known, the breaking of bread is a remembrance of us about Jesus dying for our sins. He broke His body, He spilt His blood for our sins. He made His presence known. Now, finally turning over and now I've really lost this one. It's somewhere in here, trust me. It's not in nobody else's book, I guarantee you that. Okay, it's in how about 2 Kings? And how about chapter 4 and verses 32 through 37? See, while y'all, I give y'all time to turn there, I'm trying to find my own self. Okay. Here we find, we're going to read these verses. And when Elisha was come into the house, behold, the child was dead and laid upon his bed. He went in therefore and shut the door upon them twain and prayed unto the Lord. And he went up and laid upon the child and put his mouth upon his mouth and his eyes upon his eyes and his hands upon his hands. And he stretched forth himself upon the child, and the flesh of the child waxed warm. Then he returned and walked in the house to and fro and went up and stretched forth himself upon him, and the child's knees 7 times. And the child opened his eyes, and he called Gehazi and said, call the Shunammite. So he called her. When she was come in unto him, he said, take up thy son. Then she went in and fell at his feet and bowed herself to the ground and took up her son and went out. So this storyline is that this Shulamite woman provided Elisha with a place to stay when he passed through there. It provided him a little room and his own little desk, if you will, and candle and all this stuff. And so in return, God provided her with a son. But look what happened in verse 32. The child was dead. Now, we might, when we think of child, we think of someone as a very little, but in verse 18, it tells us that he was actually old enough to go out into to his father's fields. So we're not talking a little child, we're talking a child, adult, young adult child maybe. But so what happened was, when this child happened, look in verse 33, what did Elisha do? He went in and he prayed unto the Lord. He prayed. And then he done all these other things. He laid upon this child and he done whatever he did. And in verse 36, the child sneezed and opened his eyes. He was alive again. How soon, how quick did God make His presence known instantly? It didn't even take all day, it didn't take a week. God made His presence known. Listen, God makes his presence known in our lives every single day. Now, he brought the boy back to life. He made his presence known. This is the same God we're serving today. The same one. That right there, think about that. Think about who we are serving. Remind ourselves that God, that God right there is your God and my God.
Amen.
It's the same one.
Amen.
The same Holy Spirit that Peter and Paul were filled with is in you today if you're a born-again child of God. We've got the same one. It's not a different one. It's not a weakened down version, as some of us would have it to be. It's not a shadow Holy Spirit. It's the real deal.
Amen.
Living within every born again child of God.
Amen.
Prayer moves God to make his presence known in our lives. God is still performing miracles today. He's not bringing anybody back to life. Don't let nobody kid you, all this stuff in the world going on today. That's not God's style anymore. He did it when he did it because it was needed to be done at that time. So not only for their sake, for my sake and your sake, we read about it, we know it's true, and we know what happened. We know how powerful God is. Jesus says, I am the resurrection. I am the truth. I'm the life. And also no man can come to God except they come through Jesus. You're not going to go to him around. You're not going to do an end run around him. You got to go through his blood to get to God. But God's still God. He's still all powerful. He's still in our life. He's still making his presence known. He's still performing miracles. He's not bringing us back, people back to life today. He's going to do that one big wham, bam, and the rapture. We're all going to meet him in there, right? Okay. Now. And forever be with the Lord. Forever be with the Lord. Now, in the last year, we've seen miracles performed here at this church. We have. There's been people, maybe not here per se in the congregation, maybe so, but people connected with. They're not supposed to be alive today, folks. They're not supposed to be, but they're here. God performs some miracles. People shy away from that word. They act like it can't be done no more. I know in my lifetime that by what they've called medical science, I've witnessed people that all they had to do, and I've actually witnessed them unplugging all their machines, and in 2 minutes they was going to be able to declare them legally dead, and they didn't die. They would go on to live months and get up and walk and live productive lives. I've seen it happen more than once. I know from where I speak, and I've seen others that would just, he would just take them on. They would, after 2 minutes, they were gone. Why? Because God is life. Our life is in his hand. Because it's his. We are his. He has that power. He uses the ones that we read about and the ones we experience in our life to make his presence known to us. This brings me to the Holy Spirit. We pray the prayer, we pray to God through the Holy Spirit. The Bible teaches us the Holy Spirit is our intercessor. He goes to, I have been at a loss for words. I didn't know what words to utter, and I thank goodness the Holy Spirit knew what I needed to be said to God and to Him through Jesus, our mediator who sits at His right hand. The Holy Spirit would say, Jesus, this is what is needed right now. And He'd say, God, here to answer that one. And He does it for every child of God that's in tune with God. So it's the Holy Spirit. But in that case then, why? Why have the Christians become timid and afraid concerning the Holy Spirit when things happen? You know, why are they afraid to say the Spirit moved me to do this? Or the Spirit led me to do that? Or the Spirit changed my message in the middle of the week? Why do we find ourselves, have we gotten to the point that we're afraid other Christians might look at us and think, well, you're just overboard. You've done one extreme. Are they going to look at us and say, you're crazy? They did. These Christians looked at that young lady, didn't they, and said, yeah. Why have we got timid in proclaiming the Holy Spirit in our lives and the things we do? Instead, we find ourselves, sometimes we say things like, something told me to go there. Something told me to do this. Something told me to do that. I just felt like I needed to go say something to that person. Why don't we just say the Holy Spirit moved me to do it and be done with it? Maybe that'll catch on. You know, we start giving the Holy Spirit some credit in our lives. Maybe it will embolden other Christians to do the same. Who knows? But one thing I have found myself knowing for sure, I'm not going to limit myself to letting the Holy Spirit, or not letting, but acknowledging the Holy Spirit only talks to me on special occasions, okay? I'm not going to do that. That's like going to church twice a year, and we know the 2 days people go. I'm not going to limit myself to tell people once a year, twice a year, oh yeah, the Holy Spirit told me to do that. I'm not going to tell someone, you know, I just felt like I needed to do this. Why not just say, if you're a child of God and you felt moved by the Spirit to do it, please say, the Holy Spirit moved me to do this. I thought it was going to be on time. You know, God still is performing miracles today. He is. I look around, I see some. I know. I wish I had time, and I could not tell you without just breaking down, but just for a second, I will tell you, I spent a whole Saturday after 7 days of my wife being in intensive care, almost dying a dozen different times with practically no hope, and me praying all day nonstop. And God heard and answered and performed a great miracle in her life. She's here today because of that. He's still performing her. He's still in the soul winning business. He's not only in the big things, he's in the tiny things. He's in the little bitty, the minute things of our lives. You're going to think I'm crazy. I know you probably do already, but one day I was with my weed eater and I was come apart and there was a little spring you can't really see in the gravel. I just prayed, God, I need that spring so I can finish this. And lo and behold, I looked right at it and picked it up. I give him all the credit for the little bitty tiny things. You don't have to, he's there to help us. Now, I'm gonna give you, and we need to give him the credit. I'm gonna give you an amusing little good story. It doesn't have to do with medicine. It's more of a lighthearted version, but I'll let you decide if the Holy Spirit was involved or not, okay? Just quick little message before we come to a close. But there is this lady in Dixon that I know, and most of you know her and know she's not my wife. I mean, most of you've met her. Well, I don't know, it's maybe 2 or 3 months ago, sometime back, she decides, I think there was a sale on TVs at the big department store there in Dixon. I'm not gonna call names for, I don't want people to rush down to the store thinking they're gonna get the deal she got. So anyway, everybody knows who it is. Anyway, but God, I know, getting on with it, Christy. I can read her mind, boy, that's terrible. But anyway, so she goes out there to the big store in Dixon, she looks at him, she thinks, you know, I think I might just go to Waverly and look at that big store down there. Same store, just see what they got. So she did, she went down there, and she went back to the TVs, and there was a man standing there, and he said, can I help you? She said, well, I might be interested. And I'm trying to make a long story short here. So long story short, he talks her into getting the TV, and so she buys it, and he says, I'll tell you what, you just go on, and I think it was probably the manager, but I can't say for sure. Because this is working off a bad memory of something she told me. Actually her sister told me, but it's still the same story. But, so, he said, you just go, when you get done, you go up front, it'll be up there waiting for you. And so she did, she went up to the checkout counter, and she saw, so I'm gonna pay for my TV. She said, the cashier, she said, it's paid for. And she said, what? She said, yeah, it's paid for, you don't owe a penny. And so, you tell me what you think, whether the Spirit moved a person to drive that far, that distance, to go to a store that she had no clue she would get a better deal without something to tell. And she's a Christian lady, a good Christian lady. So we can say, well, something just told me to do it. Yeah, something did, all right. If it's something good in your life, God was in it, okay? Maybe not the TV being a good thing. That's irrelevant. That's not the story. Forget the TV part. It don't matter about that. It's a matter of the fact that what transpired took place. If something good in your life, you save money, that's a good thing in my book, every day. You save that kind of money. It was not a cheap set either, by the way. So if something good in your life happens, it's God that did it, okay? Give God the glory. If something bad takes place, the devil did it. And let it be known that he's not good. He's evil. Coming to a close, if there's a person here lost, do you want to hear God? Do you want God to hear and answer your prayer? Now, we hear people pray, say, oh, Oh, I'll pray for you. The laws tell people. I'll